Okay. We're now back on page Roman 29 or Roman 27 in the doctor's opinion at the top of the page. We talked about this business of restless, irritable, and discontented. We're going on the third line down from the top. Speaking now again about people who are in active drinking. After they have succumbed to the desire again, as so many do, the phenomenon of craving develops. They pass through the well-known stages of a spree, emerging remorseful and with a firm resolution not to drink again. Now notice that Dr. Silkworth has his priorities straight here. They succumb to the desire again, which means that the obsession to drink, the compulsion to drink has kicked in. The insanity of that first drink has taken place. Thereafter, the phenomenon of craving develops. And then they pass through the well-known stages of a spree. Now, I guess it's obvious, and yet sometimes I think we don't connect the dots. The phenomenon of craving is dormant, does not exist except as a potentiality until we put a drink in our system. And so it's a two-headed monster. If we succumb to the obsession, compulsion to drink, if we give in to the insanity of that first drink, even in spite of knowing exactly what the consequences are likely to be from sad experience, nevertheless, that first drink sets off the physical phenomenon of craving. And thereafter, any hope of stopping is probably completely gone. So that's what happens. And therefore, you know, what we're really looking at here, since we cannot solve the allergy, remember, that's something which is in us and is incurable. Then the solution has to be not to ever take another drink. That's why there's no way in the world for alcoholics to stop or modify. To modify would mean that we were to begin to drink rationally and responsibly, like some of the liquor companies say. We can't do that. We can't do it because we are triggered not by some outside thing, but by an allergy which forces us into a place where we cannot stop drinking. So it's the first drink, they say around here, that gets us drunk. Going on, he says, this is repeated over and over. And unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery. Now, Dr. Silkworth is using a buzzword here, psychic change, entire psychic change. But what he realizes, because, and we know this for a fact, because later on in his opinion he talks about prayer. He's really talking about a spiritual awakening or a spiritual experience, an entire psychic change. Now, the big book expresses this differently. Remember in the promises where it tells us our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. And we will have this spiritual awakening. And Dr. Silkworth says, unless this happens, there is very little hope of his recovery. On the other hand, he says, and strange this may seem to those who do not understand, once a psychic change has occurred, the very same person who seemed doomed, who had so many problems he despaired of ever solving them, suddenly finds himself easily able to control his desire for alcohol, the only effort necessary being that required to follow a few simple rules. Well, now people are always telling us that there are no rules in AA. Dr. Silkworth would not agree with that, of course. As a matter of fact, the big book doesn't agree with them either. You can either accept the word rules or code or directions. What's it tell us at the 10th step, after the 10th step? That we're going to become God conscious and experience the flow of God's Spirit into us if we've done what? If we have carefully followed directions. And three or four other places in the big book refers to the directions we must follow. And picking up that simple kit of spiritual tools, those are what we must use. And this is the way it has to be. Let's go back again to the basics. This book was written by people who had already experienced what they're writing about. They are therefore relating to us their experiences. They're not going to say, well, we didn't really have these experiences, or we had three guys over here and four guys over here and some in the middle. We're going to have to try to tell you what we all did. This is what they did. These are the steps they followed. These are the directions they followed. And therefore, the directions in the big book, since they are a recitation of the experience of those who wrote it, are going to be very specific. The only thing that is any kind of an equivocation is this. They believed that if they recovered because they did the things they're writing about here, they believed that you and I could recover too. And that's why they wrote what they wrote. They sincerely believed that they had found the answer. And so they set forth in the big book precisely what that answer was. That's why you don't find it going all over the lot. That's why you don't find any comparative stuff in here. That's why you don't find any weasel words. That's why you don't find any backing away or back. It just says flat out, boom, 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 boom. This is what we did. This is what we did. This is what we did. And here was the result. And so if we look at it from that standpoint, we have to be very, very careful not to accept the idea that somehow there's all of this magnificent leeway. Now, there may be if that's what you want to do, but not in the big book, there's not. And so, let's go back to basics again. In 1939, you could very well say scoffingly, what do these people know? Sure, they got sober. It might have all been an accident. Well, maybe they weren't really alcoholics. What do they know? I mean, there are only 100 of them. Can't say that today. Millions have recovered using what they found in here. Why are you and I any different from them? Well, the answer to that, of course, is we're not. The millions that have gone before us have blazed the path for us, and they ought to have given us the confidence that what they did is what we must do. And then we'll quit fooling around with some of this stuff where we're really looking for some outs here and there. I just had breakfast with a friend of mine, just came back from New York. He was absolutely astonished. He was listening to a lady speak who had been, she claimed 12 years of sobriety. And she said, I've just spent the last year on my fifth step. And I said, Billy, did she try to explain this to you, how you could spend a whole year taking a fifth step? No, she just spent her whole year on a fifth step. Now, I don't understand it. I don't know how anybody stays sober doing that. I really don't. And I suppose there are some people who come in here who can flat just skate. But most of us can't. And I tell you this for a fact, I sure as heck wouldn't put my life on the line with the vain hope that I might be one of those exceptions. Now we go on. The second full paragraph right in the middle of the page. Men have cried out to me in sincere and despairing appeal, Doctor, I cannot go on like this. I have everything to live for. I must stop, but I cannot. You must help me. Faced with this problem, if a doctor is honest with himself, he must sometimes feel his own inadequacy. Although he gives all that is in him, it often is not enough. One feels that something more then human power is needed to produce the essential psychic change. Though the aggregate of recoveries resulting from psychiatric effort is considerable, we physicians must admit we have made little impression upon the problem as a whole. Many types do not respond to the ordinary psychological approach. Now that's getting about as honest as you can get. And admitting failure in the face of the fact that his hospital and his profession and his livelihood depended upon holding out the hope of recovery to people just like you and me. And Dr. Silkworth is saying in many of these cases, we can't do that. Remember what happened with Bill? He'd been in the hospital for the second time, and they'd given him the full treatment. And when Dr. Silkworth was discharging him, and he had him sitting there, and he was talking to Bill and to Lois, and he frankly told Bill, he said, we can't help you. He said, you're one of those chronic alcoholics that we can't help. He said, if you don't stop drinking, you'll be dead within a year. He was totally defeated. And this has been a great mystery to people in the healing professions. Why is it that they are perfectly capable of helping people in almost every other situation, but with alcoholics, they can't help us? They run into a brick wall, and none of the things that they have learned seem to do any good. And yet, people come walking through that door, and the next time the doctor sees them, they're doing great. Their disease has been placed in full and complete and utter remission. Let's go on now. Down at the bottom of the page. I do not hold with those who believe that alcoholism is entirely a problem of mental control. I've had many men who had, for example, worked a period of months on some problem or business deal which was to be settled on a certain date, favorably to them. They took a drink a day or so prior to the date, and then the phenomenon of craving at once became paramount to all other interests, so that the important appointment was not met. These men were not drinking to escape. They were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. See how important that statement is? They were not drinking to escape. They were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. See, Dr. Silkworth had it right, didn't he? And those of us who have experienced this, and all of us in here have, we know exactly what he's talking about. All excuses have to be put aside. Because the moment that we postulate an excuse for our drinking, we immediately are looking at a dead-end street, because it means that we are not concentrating on the reality of our disease, that it's going to get us drunk, and that we don't have any power over it, and that without God in the picture, we will drink again. Now, if you want to look for why somebody slipped, the first thing you want to look at is, what were they doing before they slipped? Were they doing their 11-step? Were they taking inventory, praying and meditating? Were they helping other people? Were they going to meetings? You're going to find in every instance the answer to those questions is no. Because those of us who do not keep our spiritual condition fit through daily working of our program find ourselves in deep trouble. You see, in the big book, in the 10th step, it tells us that this must continue for our lifetime. That our job is to grow in understanding and effectiveness. Now, the understanding part of that is God as we understand Him. Grow in understanding of God. And effectiveness, we grow in effectiveness in carrying the message. So we grow in understanding of God and effectiveness in carrying the message. If you look at that, look at the 11th step. Came through, sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God. So we're growing in understanding. In the 12th step, we're out there trying to help other alcoholics, so we grow in effectiveness. And these are the job. This is what we're supposed to be doing. I was talking to somebody today who has a wonderful business opportunity, but it would mean going away from the AA responsibilities he's undertaken. And we talked about it for quite a while, and we agreed, because he's been around a long time now, we agreed that the task that God has laid out for us to do must come first, but that other tasks may be available someplace else. They will be. And so what we're not just going to walk away. We're not just going to abandon the people we sponsor or the responsibilities we have to our group. We're going to take our time and let those things be taken care of as we go. When we make the move, finally, we'll make it with a clear conscience that we did not balk or let down on our commitments. Remember, I think we talked about this before. One of the most important things that we ever can say about ourselves, or anybody can say about us, is that we have integrity. And I suppose about the worst thing anybody could say about me would be that I had no integrity. Now, if I say you have integrity, you don't need to know anything more. Nobody needs to know anything more about you. That's all they need to know, a person of integrity. If I say you have no integrity, that's all we need to know, too. It's all there in that one word. And so there is a fine line between our responsibilities to those in our world and our responsibilities to God. But if they conflict, we have to be willing to accept the fact that it's our responsibility to God which has to come first. And there just isn't any way around that, because the opposite of that would lead to disaster. And so much of the time, you see, we fall into this trap where the affairs of the world have become so pressing, and we've become kind of swollen up in our own importance and our own pride, and it's easy for us to say, well, look, I've got to do this, my business, my family, my this, my that, and God's just going to have to wait. What happens is God doesn't wait. You see, His principles are always working in our lives, and if we're not following them, we're being hurt by not following them. And if we are following them, we're being buoyed up and helped by the reason of following them. And this is automatic. There's anything we can do to stop that. There are consequences that flow inevitably from what we do. And the choices that have to be made may often be directly opposite to what we would have chosen before we walked in that door. Nevertheless, we do make those choices, and when we do, we find that our lives, in some way or another, just have so much more meaning than they could ever have had before. You see, we learn that God will give us what we need if we keep close to Him and perform His work well. Not our work, His work. And what we learn then is that when we get what we need, it's what we really wanted all along. That's a big comfort, but it's the truth too. And it may not happen immediately, but it is always out there for us. We get what we need, we're going to find it's just what we wanted all along. And we're going to find that much of the stuff that we thought in the world was so important was really petty and irrelevant. Because what could be more relevant than that we keep our spirits and our soul in good condition? That we stay spiritually fit. What could be more relevant than that? What could be more relevant than our ability to carry God's message to others and see the light come back into their eyes and see them recover? What could be more relevant than that? And these are things that we have to decide for ourselves, but hopefully we'll make the right decision. Let's go on and see what else the doctor has to say. We're not drinking to escape, we're drinking to overcome a craving beyond our mental control. There are situations which arise out of the phenomenon of craving which cause men to make the supreme sacrifice rather than continue to fight. How powerful is that? That this craving is so powerful, it will drive us right to the grave, the supreme sacrifice. In order to satisfy that phenomenon of craving, we will continue to death. And boy, we've seen that happen a lot, haven't we? It's very, very saddening. And sometimes we think, gee, I wish I could have done something for that person. Maybe I could have been a little bit more understanding. Maybe I could have spent a little more time with them. I know, I've felt that many times myself. I don't know any way out of that trap. Probably I was right when I wondered that. Probably I could have spent more time with them. Probably I could have been more understanding. Nevertheless, that phenomenon of craving is so powerful that they could not withstand it. I delivered a eulogy the other day at a funeral, the guy that I was working with, and I thought he was doing well. And then he got hold of some stuff and OD'd, and it killed him. It's very sad. Anyway, let's go on. The classification of alcoholics seems most difficult, and is much detail is outside the scope of this book. Now, there's going to be some more stuff here in these next three paragraphs where Dr. Silkworth is trying to delineate the various types of alcoholics. Actually, he does not a bad job, but we've got in the eighth chapter, starting on page 108, we have the full description of the progression of alcoholism, and it includes in most ways exactly what Dr. Silkworth is talking about here. This is a brief description that on page 108 goes for several pages in the chapter 8, and it gives us a pretty full description of the alcoholic and the the progression of the illness. By the way, it's kind of strange, you know, that this being one of the principal indicia and symptoms of alcoholism is that it's progressive, that we wouldn't find it fully detailed in our big book until we get to the eighth chapter, the chapter of the wives. That's just the way a book that's being inspired gets written. It gets written as the inspiration comes, and that was the time when Bill felt it was a good time to write about the progression of the disease while he was instructing the wives of alcoholics. But there it is, at least it's there, and we can always find it, and it's something that our new people ought to be reading, because it's the only place that they really get a chance to look at themselves and how their disease progressed over the years. Going on, he says, there are, of course, the psychopaths who are emotionally unstable. We're all familiar with this type. They're always going on the wagon for keeps. They are over-remorseful and make many resolutions, but never a decision. Now, the decision he's talking about here has to be differentiated from the resolution. We're not doubting that when they made the resolution to stop drinking, that they were being sincere. But the decision is the same decision that it talks about in chapter 7. You remember how that works out? The person is new and they've read the big book, and they've decided that they would like to have what we have, and they're willing to go any length to get it, and they're ready to take certain steps. And then it tells us that we're to say to them, we're the old timer or the longer timer or whatever we are. Well, I'm ready. If you're ready to make a decision and tell your story. Now, you see, the making the decision was, at that time, was a buzzword. We still use it, of course, in the third step, decided to turn our life and will over to the care of God as we understood Him. But for them, this decision was a decision to surrender, and it was all-encompassing. In other words, I'm going to give up, I'm going to surrender, and it was almost like a religious conversion in those days because, you see, they were dealing with the Oxfordians, which was a religious group, and they were dealing with old first century Christianity. So that the word decision there has more meaning than just at the moment thinking, well, I guess I better not drink anymore. This decision would be like a lifetime decision, but never a decision. There is the type of man who is unwilling to admit that he cannot take a drink. He plans various ways of drinking. He changes his brand or his environment. There is the type who always believes that after being entirely free from alcohol for a period of time, he can take a drink without danger. Now, that we were talking about that earlier. That's the person who isn't going to make it because their first step never gets taken. Or maybe they learn their lesson after several go-arounds out there. But so long as the idea is that we get sober for a while and then after a period of time without alcohol, we can go back and drink again and it'll be just fine. Then he goes, there is the manic depressive type who is perhaps the least understood by his friends and about whom a whole chapter could be written. Somebody mentioned that to me the other day, three months ago, about whom a whole chapter could be written, because this manic depressive, which is, what do they call it now?
Bipolar,
yeah.
Duly diagnosed,
I think that's alcohol and drugs, isn't it? And bipolar is...
mental health disorder and
alcohol. Oh, is that what it means?
Yes.
Oh, I'll be darned! I didn't know that. I thought dual diagnosed. Okay. Well, I'm glad to know that. So bipolar is taking the place of manic depressive. Now, when Dr. Silkworth is talking about manic depressive here, he's talking about somebody who is fit into the psychosis. Manic depression was a psychotic condition of extreme mania, where the person was very, very dangerous, and extreme depression, where they could very easily die because they would almost shut down. They were in mental institutions and they were being cared for there. Today, I guess it's used a little more loosely to mean somebody who has an ups and downs, maybe exaggerated ups and downs. And so this may not be applicable with this statement here, that the manic depressive who is perhaps least understood, about whom a whole chapter could be written. I think there's a lot of understanding now, isn't there, about this bipolar stuff. And I was talking to a doctor last night. He said that they're treating a lot of this with serotonin now, and it's working very well. The one thing I do know is that this is probably something we need to be a little careful about, because it would be a very easy diagnosis to make, because when we've been drinking, especially when we're first getting sober, I guess we would be all over the map in terms of our emotions and our ups and downs. Might not be a bad idea before taking a whole bunch of medication and stuff to get a second or third opinion on it. What my experience has been this, that most of the people do recover entirely from the worst aspects of this bipolarism by working the program. Not everybody, I suppose, but most people do. And so that's a whole lot better than going around doped up all the time. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Oh, I'm sorry, I just said
I... Oh, you put your finger up. You're just testing the wind or what? Or you were pointing your higher power? Okay. Then there are types entirely normal in every respect except in the effect alcohol has upon them. They are often able, intelligent, friendly people. Well, we'd all like to say that was us, right? But you know, we've got an example of that in Fred's story in chapter 3. Fred, in every respect, Fred looked like he's a perfect citizen. You know, he's a family man, and he was a professional guy, and he had a home, and he had all this stuff, and cars and dogs and picket fences, and everything was fine with Fred, except he was a drunk, and every once in a while he'd get loaded, but he didn't really think that he had any reason to be fooling around with these AA types, because after all, he'd been able to deal with life straight up for a long time, been able to solve his problems without too much difficulty. And besides, he just wasn't, he didn't have the story that they had. But they told him along the way, Fred, there will, if you're a real alcoholic, there will come a time when you'll enter into a strange mental blank spot and you will not be able to control the next drink. You will drink again. And that's exactly what did happen to him. Under circumstances where he had to admit there was no reason to drink. No outward reason to drink. Everything was fine. Thought came to him. He couldn't put thought aside. The obsession hit and he drank. And he was drunk for a week. After that, he decided these guys were right. But you see, here's a fellow who fits this description exactly. And there are a lot of people who come in here like that. It doesn't mean they're not alcoholics. It certainly does not mean that they can control or modify or stop drinking on their own. We don't know that. A lot of people come in here who are periodics. If you're a periodic, you know what I mean. That's the toughest of all because you never know when that one's going to hit. And when a periodic gets hit with the obsession, it's a, like an atomic bomb. I mean, it's boom, and it just comes right out of nowhere. And so that person who is a periodic has to be far more careful to stay spiritually fit because you never know when that's going to hit. But if we got God solidly in our lives, it won't get us. That's not too many of us are in that category, but I think Fred was probably one of those. Going on, all these and many others have one symptom in common. Listen to this now. They cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. This phenomenon, as we have suggested, may be the manifestation of an allergy which differentiates these people and sets them apart as a distinct entity. Listen to this now. It has never been, by any treatment with which we are familiar, permanently eradicated. The only relief we have to suggest is entire abstinence. And entire abstinence is for us, I think we talked about this before, but this is well, sure, of course. But that's not the way the rest of people look at it. They just want us to slow down. They want us to be able to drink nicely and like little Lord Fauntleroy's.
Like a lady. Drink like a lady.
Or peppermint patties. Drink like a lady. Why can't you just drink like a lady? What's the matter with you? Don't you understand that you are the most disgusting, awful creature when you get drunk? Why would you ever want to do that? Now, please, just don't have more than a couple of drinks, okay? And then you say, oh, yes, I promise. Absolutely, absolutely, that's what I'm going to do from now on. What they don't know is that it's two drinks about that size, and that takes care of a fifth. Okay. So, it cannot be permanently eradicated. Now, this brings us down to the bottom of that page. This immediately precipitates us into a seething cauldron of debate. Much has been written, pro and con. Listen to this now. But among physicians, the general opinion seems to be that most chronic alcoholics are doomed. And period. End of paragraph. That's the truth. So that's what we're facing. Why are you laughing about that? We don't have to face it alone, do we? What a blessing that is. Okay, this doctor's opinion gets me worn out every time I go through it.
You're doing terrific.
It's a lot of fun, though. This guy was so smart. He knew so much about what he was talking about. All right, next week we're going to continue with the doc's opinion, and we'll probably get over into Bill's story, at least the beginning of it. And I plan to be here next week, God willing, and a crick don't rise, and I hope you will be too. I want to thank you very much for allowing me to share this with you.